सेकंड, लाइक प्रिया विल स्टार्ट द लाइव सेशन वन सेकंड।
ओके
गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी, वेलकम टू एट अनदर व्हाइट आर्मी कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव क्लिनिकल क्लास ऑन आई एग्जामिनेशन। वी एक्सटेंड अ वार्म वेलकम टू आवर एस्टीम्ड मेंटर डॉक्टर चिन्मयी मैम, हु इज एन एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर एट मिंटो आई हॉस्पिटल BMCRI बेंगलुरु। वी आर प्रिविलेज टू हैव यू हियर मैम। I welcome all the attendees to the session. Without any further delay, we shall begin the session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Kunsh. It's really a pleasure to come back to White Army this season again. And yeah, let's get started. So normal eye examination. So today we are going to just concentrate on the ocular examination. And most of the things that we are going to talk today is mainly the normal eye examination. Like how does a normal person, the examination, how does it look? I have added certain photographs just to know the names, like what is an ectropion, what is an entropion, or what is a cataract, like that. But we will not be going into the detail of all these things, which will be covered later by the different White Army classes. Okay, so let's just go ahead with the examination. So generally, what are the things that is there in the ocular examination? Like if you are doing taking a medicine case, then you have cardiovascular system, you have a stethoscope with you. Like that in ophthal, you all have to get a torch with you. Of course, you all have a mobile phone handy and the light is always there, but it doesn't look very professional. So you should have a torch with you whenever you're coming for the postings. And a general examination is just the person as a whole, because there are certain clues to many diseases, like a person who has who is very tall, gigantic, maybe like it could be like a pituitary adenoma, and in the eye we may have a bitemporal hemianopia, like that. So the general examination, patients having any rheumatoid like joints, they will have a uveitis in the eye, like that. We should see, just because it's an ophthal case doesn't mean we shouldn't go ahead with the general examination of the person. So today we are not handling too much of the general examination and restricting ourselves to the... So undergraduates are mainly, we expect you to do a torchlight examination, slit lamp examination, mainly by the postgraduate students, not for the UGs. But I have included certain slit lamp pictures for you so that it will be easy for you to understand. So equipment, basically your simple torch is what we are going to be using. And assessment of your visual acuity, there are different charts which are given here. So among these charts, the common thing that is available everywhere is your Snellen's chart. Okay, so this is the Snellen's chart. And similar to that, we also have another chart looking very similar to the Snellen's chart. Okay, so this is a Logmar chart. How does it differ? So on our Snellen's chart, letters are increasing. From top, there's a single letter here, but as we are going down, the number of letters are increasing. While in a Logmar chart, there are equal number. We have five letters here, we have five on the bottom also. Okay. So everything remains same on a Logmar chart. Again, I'm not going into the construction of all these charts. So that will be another class. And for pre-verbal children, we have this picture chart. Okay. Similarly, we can also have illiterate E chart or a broken land or C chart. And we have HOTV chart for children who have duplication. So instead of B, they can tell it as D. So for those, these letters, HOTV, will not reverse either from right or from left. It appears same. So these are used for pre-verbal, like the verbal children who have just started to learn alphabets, but do confuse with certain letters like P, they can get confused with B and all. So that is the assessment of the visual acuity. So how do we do this visual acuity charting? So your chart is at a particular distance. So here, let's say this is a Snellen's chart, okay, like that. And the examiner and the patient are going to stand ideally. So this is ideally 6 meters. So that is the distance. But then many of our examination rooms may not be 6 meters. So we do have some alternatives for that. But for all practical purposes, you will assume that the distance from the chart to the person is 6 meters. And that will be your numerator. When we tell 6 by 60 or 6 by 36, 6 stands for the 6 meter distance at which we are going to test the vision. So suppose this person reads all the letters, reads the first line, reads the second, third, fourth, and he reads the last line also. So here we have 60, 36. Okay. So similarly, at the end, we have 6. So when he reads all the letters till the end, then the person's visual acuity will be 6 by 6. And this is done in both the eyes. We will be doing with right eye and then with the left eye. So we have to ensure that the person closes the eye completely with the palm, not with the fingers, because through the fingers, they can see through. Okay, so that is why it's very, very important that the person covers the eye with the palm and not with the fingers. Okay, so this is when a person reads till the last line at a 6 meter distance. So if the patient cannot see the top, so if on the chart he read somewhere till here, but he didn't read further. So he read the 6 by 36 line. So then we give his visual acuity as 6 by 36. And then we get something called a pinhole. So pinhole is a small hole, okay, in a opaque disc. So this pinhole through which we again ask the patient to read these letters. So if the person has any refractive error, he will read further down. So he can read till 6 by 6 also, or depending upon what is the thing. So with the pinhole, he can read till the end. Suppose if through the pinhole, his vision does not improve and remains 6 by 36, then it means that there is the cause of vision loss is not a refractive error, but some media opacity, like a cataract or something, media opacity. Okay. So that's about the pinhole. What happens if the patient cannot read the top letter? Kunj and Neha, the annotations are seen, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So if the patient cannot see this first letter itself, can't see the first letter, then what you do? You have made this patient stand at 6 meter distance. Now what you do? Ask the patient to walk ahead. So make him come to 5 meters. And if he can read, then you record his vision as 5 by 60. Instead of 6, we are now recording it as 5 by 60 because the numerator now is not 6 meter, but it is 5 meters. If he cannot read at 4 meter, you bring him another meter, 4 meter. And similarly, you get him till 1 meter distance. And even at 1 meter, okay, then you can write 1 by 60. Okay, that is how we are going to do this vision testing. If he cannot see at 1 meter.
Hey, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, the voice is a bit low. It's not very clear.
Oh, is it? Okay. Now, is it audible?
It's audible only. It's been audible, but it was a bit soft.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I've just come closer. Yeah. Better?
Yes, ma'am, it's better.
Okay. So, if the patient cannot see even at 1 meter, you got him at 1 meter, still he cannot see, then what you do? You ask him to start counting your fingers. Okay. So finger counting at 1 meter, you will do. So here is your patient and you ask, can you see 3 fingers or 4 or 1? So then you can write it as counting fingers at 1 meter. If the patient cannot count fingers, even the vision is not clear, then what we are going to do is hand movements. So just waving the hands right to left. So you're just waving the hand in front of him and you can write can perceive hand movements plus. Okay. And then if he cannot see the light also, you use a very bright source of light and still the patient cannot, if the patient can perceive light, you can write perception of light positive. Okay. perception of light present? If it is there. If it is not there, you have to write perception of light absent. Okay. And for all the patients, suppose this is when you have a visual chart. When you don't have a visual chart, then we are going to do counting fingers. Okay. So you just are going to show your hands same at 6 meter distance and write counting fingers at 6 meter or 4 meter, whatever. So that is at your bedside. But ideally, you have to tell your vision based on your Snellen's chart. And another important concept is projection of rays. Even though your patient has 6x6 vision, still we have to do the projection of rays. So what is this projection of rays? So on the retina, actually, so whatever vision testing that we did is a function of only your macula. So we do not know what is happening to the peripheral retina. What's happening here, here, here. We do not know what's happening in the peripheral retina. So projection of rays is a simple bedside test to know the peripheral retina. Okay. So your visual acuity is a testing of central retina, but not of the peripheral retina. So it can so happen that a person can have 6x6 vision, but have a superotemporal retinal detachment. So for that reason, you have to also mention projection of rays. So what you're going to do here is on the eye, you're going to shine the torch in 4 different quadrants and ask whether the patient can appreciate the light from different quadrants of. Ideally, it has to be a very, very point source because our routine torch is a very diffuse illumination. Nevertheless, you still have to mention the projection of rays. And how do you represent it on your chart? You can put an X mark and tick on 4 quadrants. Okay, so you can just represent it this way. Suppose a person has he does not see in the superior field or something. So that is an absent like that. So usually they will not go into too much of this, but then you have to tell projection of rays present in all 4 quadrants for all the patients. Most of the cases given for undergraduate students, the projection of rays will be normal. It's a good thing to tell after your vision assessment. And of course, you have to also tell the near vision. So near vision, again, we have a reduced Snellen's chart and we have a Jurgel's chart. Okay, so these are the 2 charts. So here it contains of a book and letters are there again. So here also N till N6, okay, N36, N24, like that. So finally, when you are telling your vision, you will write it as 6x60, right eye vision, 6x60 with pinhole improving to 6x6, a near vision of N/18 or N/6, whatever is the thing, you will mention it like that. Now, another important test, although not very important for your exams, is the finger confrontation test, which will be discussed in your neuro-ophthal classes. But this finger confrontation test is mainly important for the visual field assessment. Here, the person, examiner, and both sit at 1 meter distance, and the examiner will cover the left eye, and the observer will cover the right eye, and then we will chart the left eye. Okay, so. I think this we will skip. We will have it better in the neuro-ophthal class, but just note that we need a confrontation test. So moving to the examination of the eye. So head posture. All of you, again, like in the squint class also I told you, most of you would have taken a passport size photo. So the moment you sit in front of the camera, the person will tell slightly tilt your head to the right. You are tilting it, straighten it, chin up. Like that. So what is a normal head posture? In a normal head posture, both the ears must be seen clearly and both the ears have to be seen properly. The chin should be perpendicular to the ground. Okay. And there should be no tilt. Your head should not be tilted this side or this side. So that's a normal head posture. So here you can see varying types of head posture. So here I have a head posture to the, like a head tilt to the left side. Here, along with the head tilt, there is a face turn also to the left side. Here there's a head tilt. Here there's a chin depression. Here we have a chin elevation. So these are different types of head postures. Usually these are seen in strabismus, cases of strabismus, and some cases of astigmatism, okay? And some cases of paralysis. You have some paralysis of muscles. So those are the cases where you get head posture. Now, next thing is facial symmetry. Usually the face is symmetrical. Like in nature, there are a lot of things which show symmetry, like your coral, seashell, everything. Even the arrangement of leaves, for that matter, is very, very symmetrical. And similarly, your human face is also very symmetrical, right and left, almost similar. But a small amount of asymmetry is there in everyone. However, a gross asymmetry is abnormal. And here you can see there is some amount of asymmetry in the face. Here we don't, the nasolabial folds not seen very clearly, and the eye size is different between the two eyes. So usually in cases of seventh cranial nerve palsy, we have an abnormal facial symmetry. Otherwise, most of the cases have normal facial symmetry. The next thing after your facial symmetry we will do is the eyebrows.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, like the voice gets a bit soft, like intermittently. So like.
Oh, is it? Oh, okay. Okay. Is it audible now?
Yes, ma'am.
I think I have to come very close. Okay. So in the facial, in your eyebrows, a normal eyebrow is different in male and female. And again, because of this threading and all, it appears very different in females. Okay. So it is just on the supraorbital ridge. In your forehead, after facial symmetry, the forehead, you have to observe for excessive wrinkling or decreased wrinkling. So here, can you see the excessive wrinkling on this side? You can appreciate, all of you. And here you can see the absence of the wrinkles. So this is a case of facial palsy where you have absent wrinkles on the right side and excessive wrinkles on the right side. Okay, so almost normal, we can tell this is a normal wrinkling and this wrinkling is absent. So that you have to observe on forehead, otherwise you tell the forehead is normal. In the eyebrows, we have to tell the position of the eyebrows. So here, if you see the position of the eyebrows, it should have been here, but slightly raised. So that is because this patient has a small ptosis on this side, and to compensate for that, she is lifting the eyebrows. So eyebrows should be either normal or it will be elevated or it will be down. So where do we get a decreased brow? So here again in facial palsy, because the frontalis is paralyzed, you can see that the brow level, see the brow level here, it's lower on this side. So either you will tell eyebrows normal or raised or depressed. And next thing is about the cilia, the hairs of your eyebrow. You can have medarosis, as in this patient of Hansen's disease or leprosy, where you can see that the eyebrow still here is normal, but on the lateral side there's a lot of thinning of eyebrows. So that condition is called medarosis. Okay, so medarosis is absence or a thinning of your eyebrows, or even lashes, even on the eyelids, if the lashes are less, it is also called medarosis. In the orbit, the size, you will just tell orbit size is normal, or you will tell it is proptosed. Like in these patients, there is a proptosis. Some patients, there is bony abnormalities, like here, when there is a craniosynostosis, there may be a bony abnormality. So generally, orbit, you will write it as normal, or you will write as proptosis when the eyeballs appeared protruded forward. Sometimes the eyeball can appear shrunken also. As in here, you can see that the eyeball is shrunken. Then you will call it as enophthalmos. Okay. So either you will call it as normal, as in here, or enophthalmos, or the proptosis. There's another concept here. You are not able to see the eyeball itself. So that is called anophthalmos. No eyeball. So that is called anophthalmos. So ocular posture. So what do you mean by ocular posture? Whether your eyeballs are in alignment with each other. So here you can see both the eyes are in alignment. How do you tell the eyes are in alignment? So here we are going to use some test called the Hirschberg's test. So in this Hirschberg test, what we are going to do, we are going to throw light on the glabella. With the torch, I'm going to throw light on the glabella standing at about 30 centimeters and looking for this corneal reflex. Can you all appreciate this corneal reflex, the central light? So that corneal reflex is at the center of the pupil in both the eyes. That is when you will tell it as normal alignment, no squint or orthophoria. Okay, so that is your Hirschberg's test. Suppose your patient's reflex is not in the center. Look at the right eye. The reflex is right in the center, but in the left eye, the reflex is not in the center of the pupil, but shifted to the left. So that means that this patient's ocular alignment is not normal, but there is a misalignment. So you can tell ocular position, there is a squint. Okay, we don't really expect you to tell which type of squint. So, and that's another class. So we just note the normal is this. This is normal, where the light should fall in the center of the pupil, and it is called orthophoria. Okay, you tell it as orthophoria. So these are different types of squint. So inwards esotropia, outwards exotropia, upwards hypertropia. Okay. Now moving to the eyelids. In the eyelids, so we will comment first on the palpable fissure. So palpable fissure, and then we will talk about the upper lid and then the lower lid. Within the two lids, we will talk on the position of the lid, and then we will talk about the lid margin and the eye movements, the lid movements, and the skin. So four things we are going to tell in the lids. So normally our eyelids are vertically, we have 8 to 11 millimeters, and horizontally it is 27 to 30 millimeters. You don't have to measure for your exams. You can just tell that the palpebral aperture is normal horizontally as well as vertically. So that is enough for you. You don't have to measure everything. Okay. And the lid margins. So lid margins, if you see, this is an enlarged image. You can see on the lid margin, you have two surfaces. Okay. So the anterior margin is rounded and that contains the cilia. The posterior margin is very sharp. Okay. So this is your anterior margin where these cilia are present. And this one here is the posterior lid margin. In between the two, you are actually seeing a faint line, and that's called your gray line. Okay. So this line here is your gray line. So that gray line is the line which will separate the anterior lamella and the posterior lamella. So lid margin, you will tell, when you are telling lid margin is normal, you mean that the outer border is rounded, the inner border is sharp, and it is well opposed to the globe. And cilia are directed outward. See the lower lid, the cilia are all directed down and out. While on the upper lid, the cilia are directed again outwards and downwards. See, like this. So this is a normal lid margin. And again the position of the, so some the lid crease. So there's a lid crease here. It's very important to appreciate the lid crease, because this lid crease can sometimes tell us about whether ptosis is present. Sometimes little elderly people have a skin fold that is covering the lid. So that is called dermatochelysis, which is normal. Okay. So dermatochelysis means skin is drooping down. So that is dermatochelysis, where the skin is overhanging. But sometimes the position of the upper lid, what is the normal position of the upper lid? Even here, although it looks like ptosis, the upper lid covers 1/6 of the cornea and the lower lid just touches the cornea. While here, the upper lid is covering more than 1/6 of the cornea. That condition, we call it as ptosis. So this is ptosis. Again, here is ptosis. You can see that this patient is using her eyebrows to elevate. So that you have to, whenever there's a ptosis, the brows are raised. Opposite of ptosis is eyelid retraction. So you can see here that the lid is not covering, should have been here, but is up. Even on the lower lid, it's not touching the limbus, but more down. Okay, so this is called lid retraction. So in the position of the eyelids, it can be normal, it can be lid retraction, or it can be ptosis. Okay, so these are the three things in eyelid position. And skin of the eyelid is a very, very thin skin. So any hematoma and all very, very easily visible, and also leads to swelling. So skin of the upper lid, you tell it's normal. If it is edematous, you tell it as edematous. Skin is shiny, stretched, all that you can tell. So the cilia, as I told you earlier, is directed, should have been like this. But here, can you all appreciate the cilia turning in and touching on the cornea? So this, again, the lid margin is normal here. So there's an extra fold of skin. Okay, so that we will call it as trichiasis. Or the lid margin itself is turned in, we will call it as entropion. So coming to the lid opening and closure, here there is a lid closure, but the eye is red. So another term is blepharospasm. In the eyelid, you have to tell whether there is blepharospasm or not. Whenever the eye is red, either because of conjunctivitis or corneal ulcer or whatever, the palpebral fissure will be decreased and the patient is light intolerant. So then you tell there is blepharospasm. So excessive closure of the eye. Then inability to close the eye. Look at this photograph. When you ask the patient to close the eye, he is unable to close the eye. So that is called lagophthalmos. Lagophthalmos, because the lid is not able to close. So these are all the problems which you can get in the eyelid. Again, like I told you earlier, a swelling of the lid. So that here you can see that the lid is swollen and it is red and almost there is complete ptosis. So here you will describe the skin as, the skin is stretched and shiny and appears red in color. The cilia should be single. They should not be matted like this. So if there is matting, this is called matting. So you can tell matting of the eyelashes or no matting of the eyelashes. Again, trichiasis here. And sometimes swellings of the lid. You can have a swelling either on the outer surface or on the inner surface. A non-inflammatory swelling or transparent swelling, or depends on different types of glands of the eyelid, we can tell a swelling is present on the eyelid. Okay, detail we will go later. So that completes your eyelid. Kunsh, or sound is okay? Now is it okay?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So moving on to the lacrimal apparatus. So what do we examine in the lacrimal apparatus? So we will appreciate the puncta. So where is the puncta located? So on your lid. So if your nose is here, there is a hairy area and there is a non-hairy area. So where at the junction of the hairy and the non-hairy area on the medial aspect of the lid, the on a raised area. So on your entire lid, it's a raised area, small, slightly raised area. The punctum is present. And this punctum should be well opposed to the globe. It's a small hole. Can you appreciate this small hole? So that is the punctum. So you have to tell the puncta is visible and it is well opposed to the globe. Okay. And any swelling, is there any swelling in the lacrimal sac area? Yes or no? If it is yes, you have to tell, describe the swelling. If it is no, you tell no swelling seen over the lacrimal area. So lacrimal apparatus, you're only going to tell two things. One is the puncta. Puncta is seen well opposed to the globe. No swelling in the lacrimal sac area. If there is watering, again, different kinds of swelling. So you will describe based on how the swelling is there. And then you will actually do the regurgitation test. Okay. Just give me a moment. Okay. So how do we do the regurgitation test? So is the video playing?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
So you are pressing on the lacrimal sac area. It should not be a superficial thing. You should not press somewhere here on the bone. It should be deep, and you should know that the lacrimal sac is located below the medial palpebral ligament. Okay. So your medial palpebral ligament, below that the lacrimal sac is there. So you have to press really hard on that area. So now you can see. Okay. The pointer is...
And you will have to deselect the pen and then...
Yeah. So now you can see that on pressing, there is no fluid that's coming out of the puncta, either the usually the upper punctum or the lower punctum. And you tell regurgitation test is negative. And if the regurgitation test is positive, you tell it as regurgitation test positive. Lacrimal syringing also you need to know. However, we will skip the lacrimal syringing because you are not expected to do it. And Jones test also you should know, which will be covered in lacrimal session. Moving on to the conjunctiva, there are three parts of your conjunctiva. So this bulbar conjunctiva, the palpebral conjunctiva, and the fornicial conjunctiva. So what is visible is the bulbar conjunctiva, whatever is white. So that's your bulbar conjunctiva. And the palpebral conjunctiva is the conjunctiva that's covering the eyelid. And between your bulbar and the fornicial conjunctiva, whatever you see, that is your fornicial conjunctiva. For the lower lid, by just pulling the lower lid, you can see the fornicial conjunctiva. So till here is your bulbar conjunctiva. So till here, this becomes your bulbar conjunctiva, and covering the lid, that is your palpebral conjunctiva. Between the bulbar and the palpebral is your fornicial conjunctiva. For seeing the upper palpebral conjunctiva, you have to do the double reversion. So how do we do the double reversion? So using the fulcrum of one finger, all of you will know because most of us would do this in your school, but you should know a single finger technique or a double finger technique. So just see it once again and play. So using the index finger as fulcrum and holding the cilia, you are everting. Okay, so that's how you evert the upper lid. And what you see is the palpebral conjunctiva of the upper lid. We are still not seeing the fornicial conjunctiva of the upper lid. So the superior fornix, we cannot see. To appreciate the superior fornix, we have to do something called as double eversion. Okay, so we have to do double eversion with the help of a Desmar's retractor. Okay, so that is your, you are not expected to do double eversion for your exams. You will just tell bulbar conjunctiva and palpebral, you can tell everything is normal. I haven't done the double eversion technique. Now, what are the abnormalities that you can get in the conjunctiva? So you saw that the normal conjunctiva looks very, very, it's a transparent sheet, right? So what we are actually seeing is the sclera, not the conjunctiva, because the conjunctiva does not have any color. Okay, so when the conjunctiva is normal, you will tell conjunctiva is clear. When the conjunctiva is not normal, you will tell depending on whatever is the condition. So if you are seeing increased blood vessels, so then you will write it as there is congestion of the conjunctiva. And depending on what is the type of the congestion, so here in this first picture, you can see that the congestion is more towards the fornix, but around the limbus, it appears very clear. Whereas here, the congestion is more deeper, more you can see more blood vessels compared to here, and it's localized to one particular area. In the last picture, you can see that the congestion is more near the limbus. The rest of the conjunctiva appears normal. Okay, so here you can see the first picture is that of the superficial congestion. The second is a deep congestion. The third one is your circumciliary congestion. How you can appreciate all the three different types? In the CCC, it's centered around the limbus. The vessels are radial. They're radiating like this. The deep are branching very variously. See, there is one on the top and there's another layer in between. And here in the superficial congestion, it's very superficial. The deeper thing is not there. So these are the three different types of congestions. Contrast to subconjunctival hemorrhage, where it is a bright sheet. Okay, there is no blood vessels seen, but the entire area is a diffuse sheet. Okay, so these are the abnormalities related to redness in the conjunctiva. So upper fornix, again, you have to do mainly in cases of allergic conjunctivitis. For papillae, you can see some raised areas. So those are your papillae. And sometimes the conjunctiva appears slightly dusky or melanotic, again, a case of conjunctivitis. And the conjunctiva is also used to check for anemia. Common, very commonly, it's used to check for anemia. You can also get some folds. This is simulacrum. So in conjunctiva, you will tell that conjunctiva is normal or there is congestion and it is either superficial congestion or deep congestion or CCC or there is a pterygium, whatever. Okay. Moving on to your limbus. Normal limbus, it is the junction between the cornea and the sclera. So in the limbus, you can see some pigmented areas here. Can you see small pigmentation that's seen? So those are your limbal palisades of Wok. This is a normal thing seen in everyone. So these are the palisades. Okay. So these are the limbal palisades of oak where the stem cells are present. So in the limbus, you can have any pterygium, you can have a nodule, you can have a dermoid, you can have OSSM. So here they may ask you differential diagnosis for limbal nodule. So that is the thing in limbus. So the sclera is white in color and it's avascular structure. Whatever blood vessels is seen in the episclera, not on the sclera. And in children, the sclera may appear slightly like a very faint blue. In adults, it's quite white. And for some people, pigmentation can be seen. If the sclera is completely red like this and area, then this is a case of scleritis. Okay. So you saw episcleritis that I showed in the picture. This is scleritis with an area of necrosis. This is the complete necrosis, avascular necrosis of the sclera. And you can also get staphyloma in the sclera. So abnormal things that you see in the sclera are scleritis or staphylomas. Now moving on to the cornea. In the torchlight, we can fairly examine good detail of the cornea. But the slit lamp is very, very important in examination of the cornea. That slit lamp biomicroscopy, whatever we use, because we have to examine the cornea as a section. So that is not possible with our torchlight. We can only see what is happening on the surface. We cannot see what is happening in the layers of the cornea. So the slit lamp is very, very essential for examination of the cornea. However, for undergraduate students, you will only write based on torchlight examination. Some old people can have, so in the cornea, mainly we are going to talk about the size of the cornea, the shape of the cornea. So size, usually it's a kind of oval, not a perfect circle. So vertically about 9 to 10 and horizontally about 10 to 11 millimeters. That's your horizontal and vertical measurements. You can just tell cornea is normal in size. Shape is light, not a perfect circle, a slight elliptical thing. So that is the size and shape. And then the surface. So surface appears smooth. When do you tell the surface is smooth? So in your home, there are different types of flooring, right? Some people may have a cement flooring, some may have a red oxide flooring, some may have marble or granite. So when do we tell it is smooth? Do you tell a cement surface is smooth? No, because you do not see the reflection. So when we tell smooth, it's a perfect smooth. So you should see the reflection back. So what we actually observe is this corneal reflex. So can you see my torch reflex on the cornea? So that reflex should appear smooth. If it is appearing smooth like this, then the cornea is smooth. However, if my reflex is getting broken like this, that means the corneal surface is not smooth. It is irregular. Okay. It's the same thing. Like in the mirror, our reflection is perfectly smooth. But in the tiles on the floor also, we see ourselves. But then you can see that the image is not a perfect. So that is about the surface of the cornea. It is smooth. And then the next thing we tell is luster or sheen. Sheen means wetness. So the cornea appears wet. So if it is appearing wet, then normal sheen is present. Okay. So cornea, you will tell size, shape, surface, sheen, and transparency. So transparency, when you tell it is transparent, you mean that you are able to see the underlying structures. It is just like your watch. So if you have a watch and you are seeing the dials, that means it is transparent. If you are not able to see inside, it means it is opaque. Okay. So when you tell the cornea is, just the cornea is a watch glass, like on your glass, what is fitted? So the cornea is just fitted on the iris, but it's not just a watch glass. It is the most important part, because from there only the light rays are getting converged. Okay, so that is the first refracting layer along with the tear film. So major bulk of your refraction is happening at the cornea. It's not just a glass like structure. So you will tell cornea is transparent. Here in this particular patient, as you move from center to the periphery, you can see slight opacity that's happening to the peripheral area. So that is a normal thing. Most of your cases, cataract cases, are elderly patients. So in the corneal examination, it would be good if you appreciate the arcus senilis. So this is the arcus senilis that you are seeing, the grayish area. So arcus senilis present or absent. You can also tell that. Otherwise, rest of the cornea is clear. And moving, just showing you some abnormalities. See, mother and child, what do you observe in this picture? Size of the cornea.
It's increased in case of the child.
Yes. So you can very well appreciate that the child's cornea is way larger than the mother's cornea. So actually you will think a child's cornea should be smaller, right, than the mother's. But here you are seeing that the mother is having a normal cornea while the child is having a large cornea. So that is a case of megalocornea. So you can tell cornea size normal or enlarged, megalocornea or microcornea. The opposite is microcornea. So that's about the size of the cornea. The other thing is buphthalmos. Between megalocornea and buphthalmos, along with the cornea, the sclera is also enlarged in buphthalmos. Okay. So in megalocornea, only the cornea is enlarged. While in buphthalmos, the cornea plus sclera enlarge and the sclera appears bluish. So that is buphthalmos. The whole eye ball as such is enlarged. Then here the cornea is not clear. The transparency is lost. Okay. So you will tell it as the cornea is opaque. Here we are seeing the whitish discoloration on the cornea that you will tell. Now you want to tell it as a ulcer or you want to tell it as a opacity. How do you tell that? That is based on the conjunctiva. If the conjunctiva is red, inflamed, then it is a ulcer. If your conjunctiva is not inflamed, then it means the ulcer has healed and it has formed a scar. So there are two things to see when you are describing a white lesion on the cornea. There is a white cornea. And a white conjunctiva. Then it becomes a scar. But if you have a white cornea but a red conjunctiva, that is an inflammatory condition and that becomes an ulcer. So you can have a large ulcer like this or a very, very small ulcer like this. Again, between bacterial and fungal ulcer. How do you expect the patients to be? This particular patient having a very tiny ulcer, this person having a large ulcer. If you look at them, the person with the large ulcer is very comfortable not closing the eyes. But the person with the small ulcer, there is disproportionate to the symptoms are disproportionate to the sign. The sign is very, very mild here, but the symptoms are more. So that's a very, very characteristic feature of your bacterial corneal ulcer. Okay, so this is related to the transparency of your cornea. So now let's move on to the sensations. How do we check the corneal sensations? So we take a cotton bisque and ask the patient to look forward. And the moment you touch the cornea, the patient blinks. So this you actually know. Even all of us, anything which falls into our eye, it is so uncomfortable. So the cornea is heavily innervated by the trigeminal nerve and it is more in the center than your periphery. So when you are representing the corneal sensations, so you will write it like this. Corneal sensations, if it is normal, you write N in everything. If it is decreased, you just write decrease, decrease, decrease. So corneal sensations, decreased or normal. So that is the thing. Further, we can stain the cornea for any abrasions or ulcers. We can do this as an advanced test. Endothelium, we cannot see in torchlight, but you should know the number of cells per millimeter square, about 2,800 cells. That is seen by specular microscopy. In torchlight, we cannot see the endothelium. I just put in a picture, slit picture of the cornea, and you can appreciate fine dots here. So those are your keratic precipitates, which are seen in uveitis. Okay, so that is the endothelium. And curvature also, sometimes in a gross keratoconus, you can see inside profile, you can see instead of a normal curve, it is cone shape. So keratoconus, so curvature. So in your cornea, what are the things to summarize examination of the cornea? We talked about size, then shape, surface, sheen, transparency, okay, and curvature, and your sensations. So these are the things that we will examine in cornea. So you can remember there are five S in this: size, shape, surface, sheen, and sensation, and then one T, five S and a T, transparency. Okay, curvature you can skip. So that all the things you have to examine in cornea, it's very, very important, because many times corneal ulcer case is given. So you remember five S and one T. Okay, in anterior chamber, what is anterior chamber? It is a area bounded between your cornea and the iris. So that is the anterior chamber, and it is 2.5 millimeters in depth. Usually it can become shallow if your iris is forward. It can become deep if the iris is posterior. Okay, so how do you check the normal depth? You shine a torch from the side and see the illumination of the opposite limbus. So if you put light on this limbus, the opposite limbus here should get illuminated. Okay, so when the opposite limbus gets illuminated, it shows that the anterior chamber depth is normal. Patient should not look near your torch. If the patient looks near your torch, it will appear normal. Although it is a shallow, it will look like normal only. So the patient should be looking straight ahead. Okay, so that's a normal anterior chamber depth. And here I'm showing you a shallow anterior chamber. So can you see this? So if the iris is like this, you are shining the light, it will obstruct and cast a shadow on this part. So here you are getting the iris. There is a shadow over here. So that is a shallow anterior chamber. In the slit lamp, I just put in a slit lamp picture for you to appreciate the depth. As we move the slit from side to side, you can see the anterior chamber is deep in the center and becomes shallow on the periphery. Okay, so this is important to grade your anterior chamber depth based on the Van Herrick's grading. So here we have a illuminating and a viewing arm on your slit lamp. The both are locked at 60 degrees and magnification at 15, and we grade the anterior chamber. What is the content of the anterior chamber? It's normal. Normally, there is aqueous. How does the aqueous look like? It is anything that is transparent will not appear different. It is on slit lamp appears kind of black or optically clear. We can tell the contents are normal. When you tell contents are normal, you mean aqueous is present. So sometimes we will tell cells and flare are present. That again, you cannot examine in torchlight. So I'm going to skip this. So the next thing is how do we examine the anterior chamber cells and flare? With this thick beam, we cannot appreciate the cells and flare. So what you have to do to examine the cells and flare, you have to decrease the beam size. You have to decrease the beam size to a very tiny spot like this and then see. So between the two spots, if there are cells, they will start appearing. So that is the way to examine for cells and flare in a small beam of light. If there is abnormal content, as in this case, what are you seeing here? Abnormal content. So here we are actually seeing the hypopyon. So you can see that there is a hypopyon. Can you see this? So in the anterior chamber, there is a white colored collection in the inferior part here. So that is your hypopyon. And central cornea, there is an opacity. So a case of corneal ulcer, circumciliary condition. So abnormal contents can be either pus or blood. So in the anterior chamber, you will tell the anterior chamber is normal in depth with no abnormal contents. You have to tell no abnormal contents. It will be better. Moving on to the iris, you will tell what is the normal color of the iris. Most people would observe the color of the eyes. It's like so many things, like a blue-eyed boy, or we all describe eyes are not just about vision, but it's also used like in many, many emotional settings, right? So the color of the iris, like the famous photograph that was taken in the Afghanistan war, it became famous mainly because of her iris, like a very multicolored iris, right? So the iris color is different for different individuals and it denotes ethnicity. So people with a brown or a black color, mostly Southeast Asian population. As you move more towards the temperate zones, more towards the equator, the color is more darker. Same with the skin color as well, more melanin. As you are moving to the cold climates, the color becomes lighter. It may become blue. Okay, but if you see a blue iris in a Caucasian, like in a Indian population, then it is abnormal. Okay, races, yes, of course, there's intermingling of races. And also the iris color should be same between the two eyes. Between the two eyes, if it is different, it is called, like if the colors are different, heterochromia. So, okay, heterochromia iridis is within the same eye, having two different colors. Heterochromia iridium, between two eyes, there is a different color. So the color of the iris, you have to note. And what is the feature of the iris? So you can see the crypts and collar crypts here. So can you see? So these are the crypts, this one. And this is the collaret. There is one structure, raised structure, so that's your collaret. And what you are seeing here, these lines, these are the dilator muscle. Okay, so these are the dilator muscle contractions. So these are the, here you have this pupillary roof. And these sphincter muscles are located like this, while the dilator muscles are located like this. Okay. So that is your iris. Again, in torchlight, you cannot appreciate too much. I'm just telling you in slit lamp how it looks. In torchlight examination, you will only tell the iris is normal in structure, crypts and collarets seen. No heterochromia. You can tell that. No iridodonesis. If the tremulousness of iris, if it is present, it's called iridodonesis. Freckles can be present just like how you have freckles on the face. You can also have black spots on the iris, which are just moles. Suppose a patient has got an iridotomy or iridectomy for glaucoma. They also look like freckles. So another thing for glaucoma, you will have to tell about that. Any nodules present on the iris suggest that it is uveitis. And any synechiae, see here again, the iris should be free. It should not be attached to any structure. If the iris is getting adherent to the lens, it's called a synechiae. So this is the posterior synechiae. and the shape of the pupil is also altered. It's kind of festooned pupil. So what do you mean by a festoon? It is, if you have a theater, you have these curtains, right? So that is a festoon. So here we are seeing the pupil shaped like a festoon, torna. I mean, in Kannada, they call it as a torna. So that is a festoon, like your curtains, no, right? So that's a festoon. So here you are seeing a festoon pupil. So, and also you can note that the pattern is lost. You cannot see so many crypts as in the previous case. So the previous case, iris, you was able to see a lot of crypts, collarette, and these radial things. But here you are not seeing the pattern. The iris appears muddy, the pattern is lost. So that is how you describe the case of uveitis on a torchlight examination. And I have also put you anterior sinica. Here what I showed you was posterior sinica. Iris attaching to posterior relation, that is the lens, is a posterior sinica. Iris attaching anteriorly to the cornea, this is a gonioscopic view. So that is an anterior sinica. Okay. So those are the things seen in iris. In the pupil. So normal pupil, the size is usually, the pupil is just an aperture in your iris. The size is 3 millimeters. It appears round, and it should be smooth also. It should not be irregular, and it should react well to light. Now here, between the right and the left, you can see there is a difference in the size of the pupil. So if there is a difference in the size of the pupil, you can appreciate, no? The right pupil is larger, the left pupil is smaller. Now, anyone can be abnormal. Either the large pupil can be abnormal or the small pupil can be abnormal. So generally 3 to 4 millimeter is a normal size of the pupil, while the pupil size can be even larger and can be normal also. So if the pupil is small in size, we call it as meiosis. If the pupil is large in size, we call it as midriasis. Okay. Actually, this is a normal pupil. Midriasis will be much more larger. And this condition, where there is a difference in the size of the pupil, we call it as anisocoria. Anisocoria. So the size is different between the two eyes. Anisocoria. So pupil is 3 millimeter. There is a single pupil in the center of the iris. It is 3 millimeter in size. It is round and reacting normally. Let's go on to the examination of the pupil for the light reflex. How do you examine the pupil? Most of the time when I ask students to demonstrate pupillary reaction, tendency is you go right in front of the patient, stand like this and check for the pupillary reaction. What will happen? The patient will be either looking at you or will be looking at the torch. So then the reflex that you're getting need not be the light reflex, but the near reflex. So this is a wrong way of checking. You should not be standing in front of the patient, but you should be standing in the side, and even your torch should not be in the field. The light should fall from the side only. Okay. And this very, very bright illumination, ambient light itself is so much. So ideally the pupillary reactions should be checked in a dimly lit room. The examiner is standing by the side of the patient, torch also in the side of the patient. Okay, like this. Again, it should be in a dimly lit room. Okay, we have to be standing at the side and light should fall from the side. Okay, like this. So let us see. Okay, like this. It should not, this light should not illuminate the opposite side. Whatever, it should illuminate only that side, or you can keep an occluder between the two eyes. So we will see the examination of the pupillary reaction. So when we shine the light from the side, there should be a brisk constriction of the pupil. Okay. So just keep observing only the left eye. So when we are shining, the pupil should constrict briskly to light. So initially you would have noted the pupil size is 3 millimeter. Now you can appreciate it decreased to either 2 millimeter size. So at least a 1 millimeter difference will be there. So the pupil, this is the direct reflex. Let's now observe the consensual reflex. So for the consensual reflex, there should be a diffuse illumination from below. And that diffuse illumination itself should not be so bright as to constrict the pupil. It should be a light illumination because in Indians, the iris is very dark. It's very difficult to show you without the light. So now I'm putting light to the left eye, but the right pupil is constricting. Can you see? Now don't look at the left eye, just keep looking at the right eye. The moment we put light to the left eye, it constricts. So this is the consensual reflex. The moment light is taken away, the pupil dilates. So this is the consensual reflex for the left eye. Okay. So that is your consensual reflex. We also, although your pupil is reacting to direct and consensual reflex in both the eye, we have to perform the swinging flashlight test. So this is the swinging flashlight test where we briskly alternate the light between the right and left. Reacting, not reacting very well, reacting, not reacting, reacting, dilating. Can you see? As we induce fatigue, the left pupil starts to dilate. The moment the light comes, it starts to dilate. So this is your swinging flashlight test to show relative afferent pupillary defect. Okay. So you have to, once you finish your pupillary examination, although the reactions are normal, you have to tell the swinging flashlight test also. Can you see this? After we induce the fatigue, it started to dilate. So we are inducing fatigue of the pupillary muscles by swinging the light. So swinging flashlight test. And near reflex, very, very difficult to appreciate. But if you ask the patient to just look at his nose, you can appreciate the pupil constricts. So by giving a near target, no need of a light, just ask him to look at his nose, the pupil will constrict. That is the near reflex. Now moving on to the lens. So here is a magnified view through the slit lamp. This is the anterior lens capsule. This is how a normal lens looks like. A normal lens, we cannot, the color is very, very difficult to describe. You can just tell a grayish black. That's what we tell for normal lens. So in pupil, there's something called color, color of the pupil. Many students will tell color of the pupil is black. So your pupil does not have any color because pupil is a hole and a hole cannot have any color, right? So you have to tell color behind the pupil. The color seen behind the pupil is grayish black. It is jet black. It is white. Okay. So that also goes in your pupil, the color of the pupil. So next, in the lens, in the torchlight, we can only appreciate the color of the lens. To a certain extent, we can appreciate the position of the lens also. So only two things you will tell in the lens, the color grayish black as in this case, which is normal, or depending on the grade of the cataract, white, yellowish, brown, whatever. If it's a pseudophakia case or an aphakia, jet black. If there is shining reflexes, you will tell shining reflexes. Okay, so that is the normal lens. And so this is a slit view of the lens, optical section of the eye. So in the optical section of the eye, the first thing that you are seeing is the cornea. So this is your cornea, anterior surface and the posterior surface. Between the two white thing, optically black is the anterior chamber, iris appearing brown. See the convexity of this iris. And then what we see is the lens still here. And we can see the anterior one-third of your aqueous also in your slit lamp. So this is your aqueous till here. What you are seeing is the aqueous. So this is the slit lamp biomicroscopy, which is expected from you. In the normal slit lamp, we can see the corneal section. We can see the anterior chamber. We can see the lens and we can see anterior one-third of the aqueous. So just here I'm showing you abnormal cataract, here jet black pupil, post-op, post-cataract, PCO also present, lens is also there. See the Purkinje images, you are seeing two images there, one bright image and below that is a small image. So ideally we will see three images. So this is your first Purkinje image, what you're seeing here from the cornea, and the smaller one is from the lens, smaller reflex is from the lens. Okay, so we have four Purkinje images, two from the cornea, anterior and posterior surface, two from the lens, anterior and posterior. But we can appreciate two images clearly. We can appreciate two images clearly. We can't see the other images very well. So in the next, after all this is done, you should also mention about the intraocular pressure. Generally, intraocular pressure checked by applanation tonometer, but bedside examination, we do the digital tonometry. We ask the patient to look down. Okay, the patient has to look down, and above the tarsal plate, you are going to press, not on the tarsal plate. See, tarsal plate is a fibrous structure. If you press on the tarsal plate, how will you check the IOP? You cannot check, right? So you have to ask the patient to look down, and then above the tarsal plate, that's your tarsal plate height is about 8 to 10 millimeters on the upper lid. So above 8 to 10 millimeters, you're going to press and see the fluctuation and tell whether it is like normal, very low intraocular pressure or high intraocular pressure. So that is your digital intraocular pressure. You should not do digital intraocular pressure if your given case is a corneal ulcer. If you do digital IOP in a corneal ulcer, you may perforate. The cornea may perforate. So if it is an ulcer case, you tell specifically, I have not done digital IOP because this is a case of corneal ulcer. By putting pressure, it may perforate. So I have not done. So that is your intraocular pressure. And then your extraocular muscles. Movements, right, left. Primary position, this is secondary position, right, left, up, down, right, up, right. So these are your tertiary. Straight is primary position, up, down, right, left is secondary positions, right, up, left, up, right, down, left, up, left, down are tertiary positions of gaze. So this also we will tell like this, up, down, and these are your side. Okay, so usually we will not represent like this. We will only represent either this way or this way. Okay, so that is your extraocular movements. Sometimes movements may be limited, as in this patient, you can see here, she right eye is moving, but the left eye is not moving. So in some cases of squint, the movements may be abnormal. Posterior segment evaluation, again, we cannot see with torchlight. But you should know about the posterior segment, normal anatomy, the disc in the center. This is the macula and you have the different blood vessels. I have just put in a small video of the direct ophthalmoscope examination. See, if given an opportunity, you have to see, learn at least to appreciate the red glow, and whatever specialty you take, please, please learn to check the disc at least, because you may become a pediatrician, you may become a general medicine person or a neurologist, neurosurgeon. So the optic disc gives an important view of the status of the brain. So in case of raised intracranial tension, you can see papilledema. So you can keep a handy pocket ophthalmoscope. Pediatricians will send to us to see if there's a papilledema or not before doing LP. If you only can appreciate, you can pick up things early. Even before imaging, if there is papilledema, you know there is a raised ICT. Patient may have a tumor. Okay, so I have tried to capture this. Let me see. So through the distant ophthalmoscope, if you, I have just put in a camera and see that the moment it reaches the pupil, there is a bright red glow. Can you see that? The red glow is seen. And as you go in, you start seeing blood vessels. And then you start seeing the disc. So this is how an ophthalmologist will look through the ophthalmoscope. The distant direct ophthalmoscopy is important for us to see the red glow. This red glow you can even see in your smart cameras. If you put on a flash and take a photo also, you will get the red glow. It's very important because patients with cataract, retinoblastomas particularly, this red glow is absent. So it's a very simple thing and all of you must know about this red reflex. There are a lot of softwares to abolish this red reflex on the cameras, but this simple red reflex test gives us a clue in children about retinoblastoma. So that test is called Bruckner's test. It's a very simple screening test for ruling out retinoblastoma. And distant ophthalmoscopy, when you have postings, I don't know when you guys will have postings, but when you have postings, catch hold of some postgraduates or staff and try to appreciate this. Okay. And finally, you have to come to the diagnosis. If it's normal, you are going to tell right eye normal, left eye normal. If it is abnormal, depending on whatever is the condition, you will tell the diagnosis. Both eyes. Many times you will tell the abnormal finding and forget the normal. Left eye, SIMC, left eye, senile immature cataract. What about the right eye? You should also tell right eye is within normal limits. Okay, both eye, right and left. And if the patient has any other condition, diabetes, hypertension, mention that also. Okay, so additional systemic findings you have to tell. Management, again you have to write investigations and the treatment, both. Okay, so I guess I have finished examination of the normal eye with some images because I put in the images so that you know important findings. We have here with us Kunj and Nehu, who have been like very, very helpful in our previous sessions also. And Neha has volunteered to present a normal case. Okay. How will a normal examination of a normal person be? It's important for you to know this because in most of your cases, there will be abnormal finding only in the lens. But you have to tell rest of the findings as normal, normal, normal. So when you keep telling normal, 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 even the examiner will find it very annoying. And also it doesn't sound well. When you're presenting a case, it should be like you're telling some story. So that Neha is going to demonstrate how a normal case, a normal person's examination would be. So over to Neha.
Ma'am, hello. Just a minute, ma'am. Thank you so very much, ma'am. The videos were amazing. I mean, I have no words to describe. I joined in late. Just now we had a patient of retinoblastoma, and then I'm seeing the DO video that you are showing, ma'am. It is absolutely priceless. Yes. I must tell all the UGs here, the way ma'am has captured all these things for you to see online is beyond, it is beyond my words. So heartfelt thank you to you, ma'am, to make such good videos and be so lucid in your presentation. We look forward for more of your classes and more of your videos and descriptions of them. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you very much, Neha. Thank you, Ramya. Thanks a lot. And we'll just end this presentation with the normal case sheet.
Yes, yes. Over to you, Neha.
Thank you, ma'am. I'll be presenting a normal case sheet. So we begin with patient particulars, chief complaints, history of presenting illness, the treatment history, past history, family history, personal history, general physical examination. And then go to eye examination. Since it's a normal case, everything is applicable to both the eyes. Visual acuity, distance vision was checked using Snellen's chart, and it was 6x6 in both the eyes. And near vision is checked by Jagger's chart and found to be N by 6. Since the visual acuity is 6 by 6, I didn't do the pinhole test. But if it was abnormal, then a pinhole test should be done. Projection of rays, it's normal in all quadrants. Facial symmetry, bilaterally symmetrical. The head posture is normal. Forehead has normal wrinkling is seen. Ocular posture on Hisberg corneal reflex test, it's found to be orthotrophic. Eyebrows, both the eyebrows are at the same level. The cilia are normal. Orbit, on inspection, there are no abnormalities seen. On palpation, inspectory findings are confirmed. Eyeballs, size, appears to be normal and no size difference between the two eyes. Eyelids. Eyelids position, the upper eyelid covers 1/6 of the cornea, while the lower eyelid just touches the limbus, which suggests that the position is normal. The movements of the eyelids, it opens and closes normally. Margins of the eyelids, it's rounded anteriorly and sharp at the posterior margin. Eyelashes are all directed outwards and skin appears to be normal. The palpebral aperture, it's normal horizontally and vertically. Lacrimal apparatus, puncta is seen normally, well opposed to the globe. No swelling in the lacrimal gland area. Regurgitation test is negative. I have not done the lacrimal syringing. Conjunctiva, there's clear conjunctiva in the bulbar, palpebral and fornicial conjunctiva. The lower fornix is seen by pulling the lower eyelid down. Upper fornix, ideally lid eversion and to see deeper, a double lid eversion technique should be used. Limbus appears normal, no nodules seen. Sclera is normal, there's no discoloration, no nodules and no ectasia. Cornea. Cornea is normal size, shape, sheen. Surface is smooth. It's transparent and no visible ulcers or opacity. Sensations are intact. There is no vascularization. Back of the cornea appears normal with no keratic precipitates or pigmentation. Endothelium can be seen on the slit lamp, but I've not done it here. Then anterior chamber is normal in depth with no abnormal contents. The iris is brown color. The pattern is normal. Crypts and crevices are seen. The collarette is normal. There's no heterochromia and there's no iridodonesis and no nodule seen. Pupil is a single pupil, 3 millimeter round in the center of the iris. The color behind the pupil is grayish black. Pupillary margin is smooth. Then the pupillary reactions is normal for the direct, consensual and near reflex. The swinging flashlight test did not show any relative afferent pupillary defect. Lens, it's within the pupillary margin limit. The lens is transparent and grayish black in color. On intraocular pressure on digital on digital test, it was firm on palpation. Ocular movements, the ductions and versions are free and full in all directions. And next will come the systemic examination and the summary and provisional diagnosis, differential diagnosis, investigations and treatment. Thank you.
Okay, so that kind of summarizes the normal examination of the eye. So depending on whatever is your case, so in your exams, they may either ask you to jump to the positive findings and go ahead with the thing. What I wanted all of you to appreciate is the way Neha has presented. So instead of telling pupil size 3 millimeter, shape round, that's what most of the people will tell, like cornea, size normal, shape normal, surface smooth, transparency present. So it should not be like a table, okay? While you write, it will be like a table. But when you speak, it should be in sentences. So thank you, Neha, for really presenting very nicely and writing down the case sheet, like that's the model case sheet. I hope all of you are clear. Yes,
ma'am, there are some doubts. When we perform the Hirschberg's test, if the corneal reflection is it in the center of the pupil, then do we say it is orthophoric or orthotropic?
Generally, without performing the cover and uncover test, we will tell it as orthophoric, okay? Because there may be a phoria for that person. It will look normal, but he may have a latent squint. So only on Hirschberg's test, we will tell it as orthophoria. But the patient may have squint at some time. When he has presented to you, he does not have the squint, but he may have squint when he is outdoors, when he is tired. So only on Hirschberg's, we will tell it as orthophoria. But after you do the cover and uncover test, then if you did not disclose any tropia, then we can tell orthotropia. On cover and uncover test, you did not get any movements. Then you know that for sure, this person does not have any hidden squint. So then you can tell orthotropia. So based on only the Hirschberg's test, you will tell it as orthophoria. But after doing the cover and uncover test, we can tell it as orthotropia. That is, you have confirmed the presence or absence of a latent or a hidden squint. Okay. So yes, I think, that is the only.
Yes. And ma'am, one more doubt, for checking the anterior chamber depth, on the torchlight, can we differentiate between the normal depth and if the depth is more for example, in case of aphakia, the anterior chamber is deep or not, how can we differentiate that?
Okay, so on the torchlight, basically it is very, very subjective. That is why we have the Van Herrick's grading. So it's actually very subjective. Mostly by the clue that the pupil is jet black, you can tell that it is more deep, and also the presence of iridodonesis. So if you observe a lot of normal patients, then you will know that it is abnormal. But clearly shallow is very easy to make out, but deeper, if you actually observe, you can appreciate that it's very deep. It's kind of bowing. The iris is somewhat posterior, pushed more backwards. So with that, you can appreciate.
I mean, one more doubt from YouTube. Yeah. The doubt is if we are projecting the light on the superior quadrant, then while demonstrating, which quadrant should be affected while drawing on case sheet?
Okay. So actually, when you are projecting the rays, it will be on the opposite because the retinal projection is opposite. So when I put the light on the temporal side, we are actually checking the nasal retina. So when we are putting the light on the nasal, from the nasal side, we are checking the temporal quadrant. Okay. So it is the opposite side. So when we put the light on the temporal, if the person can appreciate it, it will be the nasal retina.
So while representing on paper, we'll draw it on the nasal side of the...
So generally for undergraduate thing, mostly it will be normal. So you will just tick it as normal for all. But usually for postgraduate students and all, it is very important that they mention it write properly which side.
And ma'am, one more question from YouTube. Which book to read for ophthal for UG?
See, this is a very tricky question. So it will become we are endorsing a particular book or something. During your undergraduate thing, I would just tell you that you read not for your exams, but you just read for knowledge, and don't concentrate mainly on your cataracts and corneal ulcer. Okay. So that is just for your exams, but do read a lot about systemic ophthalmology, though it is a very small chapter at the end. See, for the rest of your life, what will remain with you is the systemic ophthalmology. A lot of any book, and try to read multiple books. So mainly you have this Kurana, you have Parsons, and one from Karnataka, also the other place book. So there are a lot of books. Basak's is there. Anything. Whatever you are reading, Additionally, you also look into the images from Kansky. Okay. So I'm not asking you to read Kansky. You read your book and just look into the images, because images will stay with you longer. Like today I showed you superficial, deep and circumcillary congestion. How much ever you read, if you just remember the picture, you can write better. So whichever book has got good pictures and representation, that will be better. And of course, your systemic ophthal, you have to read more. See, now during this COVID, we are seeing a lot of mucormycosis. In undergraduate thing, you will hardly know about mucor, right? You will not give so much importance. But now it has become so important. So like that, diabetic retinopathy, you should know everything about diabetic retinopathy, hypertensive retinopathy. So those are the things. Read for knowledge. That is what I would suggest. Not and don't do a superficial reading. Like superficial congestion, it will just stay and go off, while deeper thing will stay longer. So have a deep understanding of the subject, and it will help for other things also.
Definitely. Yes. Ma'am, thank you very much for this session. We really loved the session. The videos are very nice, and so like we could imagine that OPD scenes like depicted in the online session fully clearly. We really loved your efforts for, and the really appreciate for this the entire session.
Thank you, Neha, once again.
Thank all the attendees for the active participation, and thank you, Vandana.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.